Hallelujah. Okay. Everybody got your pencils and everything? We're going to be reading some scriptures, so have your scriptures open. First, before we get started on the actual study of the ancient Hebrew, Sister Anita is going to read the perspective of Hebrew word study so that we can kind of get an idea prior to me just launching into this like I was doing a second ago. Prior to us just launching into this new aspect that Yahweh has added to our understanding. And that once again, the purposes of this is not that you'll have to look to me for answers. That's what's wrong with churchianity right now, is because they look to the man behind the thing and they're not studying themselves.
Right.
Yahweh says to study, you study.
Yep.
To show yourself before him. Not me, I'm not going to study for you, but I want to give these tools to you. He said, as if it was a hidden treasure. I remember times in my life that if somebody told me, hey, Teddy, there's a treasure buried out back of your house, I would have been out there at night with a mag light and a spoon digging to find this thing. Because I needed the treasure. I wouldn't have used it properly or for the right reasons, but I know I would have been out there. Let's dig into what he is teaching us. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So let's go ahead and read this first part, and then we'll get into it after that.
The first and foremost concept that a reader of the biblical text must learn is that the ancient Hebrews were products of an Eastern culture, while you, as the reader, are the product of a Western culture. These two cultures are as different as oil and vinegar. They do not mix very well. What may seem rational in our Western minds would be considered irrational to an Easterner of an ancient Near East culture. The same is true in the reverse. What may be rational to an ancient Easterner would be completely irrational to our Western mind. The authors of the biblical text were writing from within their culture to those of the same culture. In order to fully understand the text, one needs to understand the culture and thought processes of the Hebrew people. All existing Hebrew lexicons of the Bible convert the vocabulary of the ancient Hebrews into a vocabulary compatible to our modern Western language. The largest problem with this is that it promotes Western thought when reading the biblical text. In this lexicon, the mind of the reader is transformed into an Eastern one in order to understand the text through the eyes of the ancient Hebrews who penned the words of the Bible. One of the greatest differences between this lexicon and others is the use of the ancient pictograph script, which Hebrew was originally written in. Because the ancient Hebrew language is based on these pictographs, they are used rather than the modern Hebrew script.
Okay, so thus far, what Jeff Benner, this is from Jeff Benner's Hebrew lexicon of the Bible. He's the one that does all of the hieroglyphic, digs up all of the old definitions, and has put it in place with us, even with the Strong's numbers available. So he's made this really easy.
This is copied out of what?
Jeff Benner's Biblical Hebrew Lexicon. And if you guys want it, I'll send you the links. You can download it onto your computer. It's really hard to use because it's like hundreds and hundreds of pages. But you can also order these books, and they're not expensive. Okay, now what he's discussing, what he's telling us right now, is that this, the Strong's Hebrew Concordance, the Thayer's Greek Lexicon, and even one of our favorites, the Brown Driver Briggs, are all, for the most part, they'll give you the concrete word of the meaning, but they don't give you the concrete definition. Most definitions that we're receiving out of these are abstract. And he's going to define the difference for us. Okay? Now, not saying that everything that we read in there is untrue. It's just not perfectly clear because we haven't received this definition yet. Only these.
Mom.
It's just like our English language now is different from the English language when the King James was first penned. I tried to read that thing online the other day, and I went, when I was doing the Saved in Whose Name series, It was problematic. I had to use the word of Yahweh to actually read from because I couldn't read it fluently. And that's English. Now we're talking about thousands of years of language and the evolution of it. And I submit to you that Brad Scott is correct in saying that the languages have not evolutionized, they've de-evolutionized. It's like drinking the water from the top of the mountain right off the snow, opposed to going down by the ocean and getting a cup of it then. That's what he's saying. Amen?
The definition of a word is going to be directly related to the culture in which that word is being used.
These are very, very important for us to understand. Listen to this.
One word may have different meanings depending on the culture that it is using it. In order to place the correct context to a Hebrew word from the ancient Hebrew language, one must first understand ancient Hebrew thought.
You remember what the scriptures tell us? Let the same mind be in you that was also in Yahshua Messiah. Knowing that he was the living word, the living Torah, what was he made up of? This or that? Now we're getting somewhere. Amen? Now he's going to go over the abstract, the difference between abstract and concrete.
Greek thought views the world through the mind, abstract thought. Ancient Hebrew thought views the world through the senses, concrete thought. Concrete thought is the expression of concepts and ideas in ways that can be seen, touched, smelled, tasted, or heard. All five of the senses are used when speaking. Hearing, writing, and reading the Hebrew language. An example of this can be found in Psalms 1:3. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. In this passage, the author expresses his thoughts in concrete terms such as tree, streams of water, fruit, and leaf.
Okay, before we finish that, those couple of paragraphs, this is something that Brad Scott has labeled agrobiological linguistics. In other words, where did we come from?
Mama.
We were formed out of the what?
Dirt.
It's all an agricultural makeup. Our body, everything in creation. Everything that we see, touch, feel, hear, has an emotional effect on our mind, which is where abstract things come. It makes us think a certain way. If we touch the fire, the flame says and burns the skin, and then we say, oh! Okay? That is the abstract is what we say concerning what we just felt. So the concrete definition was the fire just burnt me. And then the abstract would be, and I said, that's where we get these definitions for the most part in the modern Hebrew. But when we look at the action, like if when it says that the outstretched arm of Yahweh, when it's talking about that, what does he outstretch his arm to do is the way that they would look at it. Not at what he was pointing at, but the reason where the arm came from, where the strength came from, who was behind the arm that was pointing the finger or offering something at the end of his fingers. The abstract of that would be, I received this, or I gave him praise for that. You see? Very simple. This stuff isn't confusing. It's very simple. Let's finish that.
Abstract thought is the expression of concepts and ideas in ways that cannot be seen, touched, smelled, tasted, or heard. Examples of abstract thought can be found in Psalms 103, verse 8. Yahweh is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. The words compassion, grace, anger, and love are all abstract words, ideas that cannot be experienced by the senses. Why do we find these abstract words in a language of concrete thinking Hebrews? Actually, These are abstract English words used to translate the original Hebrew concrete words. The translators often translate this way because the original Hebrew makes no sense when literally translated into English. Let us take one more of the above abstract words to demonstrate the translation from a concrete Hebrew word to an abstract English word. Anger, an abstract word, is actually the Hebrew word...
That would be Aleph, Pei, Hei.
Which literally means nose, a concrete word. When one is very angry, he begins to breathe hard and the nostrils begin to flare.
See that? They would look at somebody and by their action, that's what the original language is based on, is action roots, which you'll find in the form of two-letter roots. It's the parent root, and when you begin to add little children, like he did in his picture, when you add, then it brings forth a different meaning, and in the English and in all other languages, we begin to, let's say, for instance, there's around 8,900 words in a Hebrew Bible, and there's 500,050 or so in the English. That tells you how hard it is to abstractly translate what he's speaking about here. If there's only somewhere around 8,900 Hebrew words that I believe it's in the Tanakh, maybe the Torah, don't pile me underneath a bunch of rocks if I'm wrong, but either way, whether it's the Tanakh or the Torah, there's only 8,900 Hebrew words that make up the whole thing, and then there's 550,000 in the English. That's what he's trying to say. We have to add, because of our mindset, it's all abstract, we have to add all of these thoughts to get back to the original picture.
If the translator literally translated the above passage, slow to nose, the English reader would not understand.
Right. So what he's saying is, the way that the Hebrew mind would work was, if I looked at my mom, and I seen her get off the phone, and I seen her face flush, and her then I knew that it was a sign of what we would now call an abstract anger. But they look at the features, what they see, touch, hear, smell, all of that.
Greek thought describes objects in relation to its appearance. Hebrew thought describes objects in relation to its function. A Greek description of a common pencil would be, it is yellow and about 8 inches long. A Hebrew description of the pencil would be related to its function, such as, I write words with it. Notice that the Hebrew description uses the verb write, while the Greek description uses the adjectives yellow and long. Because the Hebrew's form of function descriptions, verbs are used much more frequently than adjectives. To our Greek way of thinking, a deer and an oak are two very different objects, and we would never describe them in the same way. The Hebrew word for both of these objects is ayel.
That's aleph, yod. It's ayel. That's how we would say it. But what he's saying is that the aleph. These are the letters that make up what we would now pronounce, because that's what happened. Is we've taken these hieroglyphics that actually put together the picture for us and labeled it with modern English words and Greek words to form sentences to explain what it means. You see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Totally different. And at times we lose some of the essence of what was being conveyed through that message. We've added words to the hieroglyphics. And the hieroglyphics will picture things as we're going to see. I just wanted to get everybody kind of familiar with what we're going to study prior to getting into it, so you'll have a better understanding once we go through it.
The Hebrew word for both of these objects is ayel, because the functional description of these two objects are identical to the ancient Hebrews. Therefore, the same Hebrew word is used for both. The Hebraic definition of
El
is a strong leader. A deer stag is one of the most powerful animals of the forest and is seen as a strong leader among the other animals of the forest. The wood of the oak is very hard compared to other trees and is seen as a strong leader among the trees of the forest. Notice the two different translations of the Hebrew word
Ael
in Hebrews 29 or in Psalms 29:9.
The New American Standard Version and the King James Version translated as
the voice of Yahweh makes the deer to calve, which the NIV translates it as the voice of Yahweh twists the oaks.
See that? Because even though they're using this, even though they're just using this to bring forth and convey the definition, even abstractly, they're going to see in these books are what they use when they do this stuff. In books like this, the Etymological Dictionary of Biblical Hebrew, actually, it's not biblical Hebrew, this is modern Hebrew, but yet it'll give you the concrete definition, so you'll see it mixed in there in the English. But we must not let the abstract overcome what is being conveyed here. And I've came together with this form of study that produces what I believe is true definition by using them both. Because without using them both, like he just said, it's almost impossible for someone to understand the Eastern mind thought that was in the Hebrew without doing both. So we're getting abstract definitions out of even some of the best material that we have.
The literal translation of this verse in Hebrew thought would be, the voice of Yahweh makes the strong leaders turn.
Now he's using the definition that he has found in this language, or this form of the language. Okay? So you can see, by those verses they give you to look at, you can see the almost struggle between translators to bring this stuff over to us in a pure form of definition. And I submit that you've got to have them both, or you cannot.
When translating the Hebrew into English, the Greek thinking translator will give a Greek definition to this word for the Greek thinking reader, which is why we have two different ways of translating this verse. The same word, Ael, is also translated as a ruler, a strong leader of men in 2 Kings 24:15.
So here he gives you another verse to go over and look to see how they've translated this thing. And this is where the Englishman's concordance of the Hebrew concordance of the Old Testament comes in to play. You can get one of those. And whenever they start, you can actually look up the Hebrew number and go into that concordance, and it will show you every time that word has been used. Go to the beginning and watch how they've used it in context throughout your scriptures. And that will show you all of the abstract definitions. Then you take the abstract definitions and you go to this form of study and you see the truth. This is simple. This almost makes you want to sit down and make a translation yourself. Okay, because, I mean, that's what's going on in your mind and in your heart. He is translating and conveying through these forms of study what he was picturing to us, just like this child did to us when I asked him to draw a picture of his mother, his father, and his family. It was all stick people. This is a simplistic way of study. It is the easiest form of study, but yet it produces the most information that Yahweh wants us to have. A child can understand these things. Okay, now, everybody, you want to take this and either highlight or underline the fifth letter in the Hebrew alphabet, which is the He. Highlight or underline that. And then the 12th letter, which is the Lamed. And you could probably underline it all the way from the right in the modern Hebrew, underline it all the way over to the left where you see the hieroglyphics. Because we're going to be, that's what we're going to study first, is this word, Hallel, in Hebrew. H-L-L, Hallel. You will find this word translated in the Strong's Hebrew section of the concordance there as number 1984, and this should sound very familiar to Sister Anita. Yeah. Because this is what she used. She researched this word to write, which song was it?
My Sacrifice I Bring.
Yeah. My Sacrifice I Bring, that she played the last Shabbat we met. Now we're going to see that she's probably going to write another song. Watch. Watch how much this is amplified. And so you're really going to be, you're really going to gain some understanding.
I'm still studying, so I'm really excited. I'm still in
right.
this study.
Okay. So if we have those two words highlighted, something I want to point out before we go into this. I'm going to do this. You guys don't have this paper, but in the next part of the study, you will have that paper before you. This is the hay, the lamed, and the lamed. This is also the three-letter root of a very familiar word that we say very often, Hallelujah, which is a short form of Hallel you Yahweh. Hallel Yahweh. Hallelujah. People say Hallelujah all the time. They have no idea what they're saying.
It, by the way, is the only word that is the same as it was in the ancient, and it is the same in every single language.
Exactly, one of the things I was going to bring up is that is exactly what has happened. You see that it's been abstractly defined as praise, and I submit to you that that's what we are doing today, according to what these hieroglyphics show us. We are going back toward Him. And when you look toward Him, He is being praised. It's an action. Deja vu. It's an action that brings praise to Him. It's not the words that are coming out, but the intent of the heart to look up to Him and seek Him. That is what this hay is all about. Amen? Hallelujah. Okay, so if everybody's got those underlined. All right. What I want to do is kind of demonstrate the need of the study of the ancient biblical Hebrew and how important it is for us to understand it. Okay? Because we're going to share this stuff with people. And when we share this information, what is happening to Him? He's being praised. His purpose, the fruit, it's got to do with fruit. It's got to do with the kingdom and the amount of souls and beings that is being regathered at this time in order to give Him and produce this abstract thing we call praise. It's very, very significant for us to understand these things. Okay, so the word I have here that I've chosen to use is Hallel. This is it in modern Hebrew. And this is it in ancient Paleo Hebrew. And we're going to be looking at the definitions of these words, and we're going to see some very symbolic things. All right? Of course, this is written in the modern Hebrew script. But what we need to ask ourselves is, it would be smart to do this, is ask yourself, where did the modern Hebrew come from? Well, I never did that early in my walk. I just thought that was Hebrew and that's the way it was. But now, I've asked myself that question, where did that come from? History shows they had to adopt other alphabets whenever they were in bondage. This is actually Chaldean. And it's also a form of what we now know as Aramaic. Okay, so is that the original? Absolutely not. So if there's a definition that's given in our language now, would it be the same as in Old English? A lot of times, no. So that's what we're doing here. We're kind of, we're delving into another area of the Hebrew language and bringing clarity to what we know and understand. Okay. Hebrew was originally written with its pictographic script similar to the Egyptian hieroglyphics. When Israel was taken into captivity in Babylon, they adopted the Aramaic or Babylonian script of the region and used it to write Hebrew. So what they're saying is the alphabet that they adopted was different, but they tried to keep the same definitions of this in it. But as years went by, all of the captivity and all of the mindset that was instilled within these people began to change in definition as well. Their thinking process. That was one of the things that the adversary does. Whenever Alexander the Great was conquering the world, the first thing he did was set up a school when he conquered you and said, you're going to learn how to live and think like we do. You're going to use our alphabet. And that's what the enemy has done. Wake up, assembly. He's trying to water down what our father gave us. But blessed be Yahweh, in these last days he said he's going to raise up a remnant.
Get it.
No.
That's us.
Woo-hoo. That's us. Yeah.
Amen.
Give him a little hand praise for that.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
So anyway, the modern Hebrew script used today is in fact Aramaic and Greek in origin, not Hebrew. And according to most Hebrew dictionaries and lexicons, the word Hallel is translated as praise. And once again, that'll be number 1984 in your Strong's. Okay? Abstract concepts such as praise really have no foundation in the concrete meaning and are a product of ancient Grecian philosophy. Now, let me tell you what he means by that. He's not telling us that it's pagan. What he's telling us is, let's look at the history of the people of Israel. The northern 10 tribes, especially. The upper body. The upper body. Okay, the people in the upper body of the body of Israel was what dispersed. And you know what? Maybe 10% or less of those people ever set foot once again into the land. So they became those who Yahshua's disciples went out and ministered to in the nations. He was regathering Israel and telling them, you're being pulled back into covenant. But they'd been out there for so long, what were they reading from? What were they speaking? A lot of them spoke Aramaic. There was a lot of Aramaic speaking countries around them, but for the most part, the further away you got, the more Greek you got. And they were teaching in the synagogues out of the Septuagint. So they were raised by the Greeks. And their mind was Greek. Even though they were trying to be obedient to the Torah, just like we are, their thinking pattern was different towards it than it would have been had they not sinned against Yahweh and been cast out of the land. So he's not indicating that it's pagan in origin or anything like that. It's just saying that our thinking about it has differed. Okay? So here, this is the form of Hallel in ancient Paleo-Hebrew. Now this Hebrew would have been what the Torah was originally written in by Moshe. This didn't even exist yet. Not in their vocabulary. So this is what it would have been, and this is what I'm saying. It was not hard for them to understand while they were in covenant. Notice the more covenant rules they broke, the more the adversary added to the confusion for them. So it takes a deeper desire and passion to come back to him, just like the prodigal son. He'd had enough. We went over that in the teaching for this week that I put up on the website. It's all about Israel and Judah. Without Judah being connected back to Israel and Israel being connected back to Israel, there is no Israel. There is no whole body.
And they're really at
verse to each other right now.
Like oil and vinegar. Or like, what was it?
Yeah.
Oil, what did you say?
Yeah. Oil and vinegar.
Yeah.
Or water and vinegar.
Yeah. They mix about that well.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let me just give you a little bit of history about this language. And if you'll look in the where it says middle, next to the hay, where the, you see this, where the hay is, look next to it, and it'll be the middle term. And this letter hay used to be formed like this, which is how you see the tetragrammaton many times.
Mm-hmm.
It was written like that. Or that might not be big enough for them to see. It was like this. That would be the middle form of the hieroglyphics, which is referred to as Paleo Hebrew. All right. Now, the middle form is over 3,200 years old. So this is showing us that this is what surely what the Torah would have been penned in by Moshe. Because approximately 1,500 years, a little over, transpires in between Genesis and all of that stuff that happens. So we're well into the days, or back into the days of Moshe here. With that date. Okay? And this form, that was the original hieroglyphics, but this form here, okay, dates back to between the 3,200 and 2,500 before the Common Era, BCE. So here we see, even then, we began to go downstream. All right? Anything that takes away the original meaning that was being conveyed from Yahweh in the Shemaim to his servants is an act of the adversary. Now, when does the adversary get a foothold in our life? Through disobedience. Through stiff-necked people. So we see all of these things start coming to mind in the Torah when they were doing this. Korah and all of these other people. Their disobedience started reaping these things and inviting the adversary into the home. And I submit to you, that's what we do every time we stray away from this. The original seed, the original plan that produced the original tree. Okay? Now, many times you guys have heard me, if you've watched the DVDs or been online, you've heard me say, and these verses in context show us a picture of this. That's the way these work. He shows you a picture of something. And once again, if you just have the hay, you don't have a root yet. But once you add another letter to it, now you have a root. It takes two to be complete. The scriptures tell us that Yahshua was both the root and the offspring of David. He was the root, and I guarantee you somewhere in there you're going to see this noon in the ancient paleo, because the tree from where the roots comes from the seed that was planted in the garden. It's one big picture from cover to cover. And today it's going to show us something even greater. It's going to show us how to study his word in one of the most simple and purest forms of study. And see his word in context.
Daddy.
Okay.
Daddy.
This is the two-letter root of Hallel, or Hallel in Hebrew. It would be
Daddy.
Just that. Now see, it starts bringing on other meanings after that, but here's what this two-letter root means in the definition of biblical
Daddy.
Hebrew.
Daddy.
This is a man, of course, a stick man, just like Telmer drew for us when he was drawing a picture of his family. This is a man, and he's beholding. He's looking up. He's looking to something. But you see, he also has a staff. And this letter represents the shepherd's staff. So in the context of the scriptures, you're going to see that Yahweh was either trying to shepherd his people or the enemy was stealing and shepherding the people. You will always see this letter in any verse that is speaking about being shepherded, to being called away from something or being called to something. You will always see this Lamed in the Hebrew. Now, the man looking up, he's beholding. The literal definition of that in Hebrew. Now, once again, let me make sure you understand. This would have been a story in its original form. This would have meant there's a man who is receiving something from the heavens, and he is shepherding us by it. Yahweh using a man to shepherd his people. That's how that would be defined. Or Yahweh's shepherd is looking to him for direction. Depending on the rest of the context of the scriptures, you'll know how to decipher it. It's so simple. Now, this word, or this letter, has a concrete biblical definition in ancient Paleo-Hebrew. And oftentimes it was used to convey someone staring at the star, the bright star in the sky. And it means a bright light in the night sky that is looked toward to guide one on a journey. And it's been translated abstractly as praise. But when you put those two definitions together, what you're seeing is that when you look to the heavens for your direction, especially when you're walking, coming out of darkness, okay, that you are inadvertently bringing praise to the Mighty One of Israel. By your action, you give him praise. When you seek him, he is receiving praise. When you speak to him, he is receiving praise. Remember the senses that he was talking about here. Okay? So, it's actually been translated or defined in ancient Paleo-Hebrew as looking into the star or into the skies. And it's been abstractly defined as praise in most of our Bibles, scriptures. All right. Now,
Teddy, I've got a question. The other word, Baruch, which is almost synonymous from what I've been told, like Baruch Hashem, praise the name, how is that different than Hallel?
We would have to look at it.
That's fine.
Because I don't have the book. You're with me, I just have these copies of paper. But that is something to look into. Because I guarantee you, if it does mean the same thing, but see, notice that it's not Baruch isn't made up of a hey.
No.
So it's not. In biblical Hebrew, it's not going to be the same word. It's not going to be the same word.
I thought it from the ancient Hebrew was two ways of saying the same thing, praise him.
Right, and that's when we use this.
Right.
That's when we use this form of study. And that's why I'm saying you almost have to have both forms of study in order to get the concrete definition of what was being conveyed. In other words, we've received a lot of teachings from a Jewish perspective that is all abstract. Almost every bit of it is abstract. But, once again, you must have the abstract in order for you to understand, but then you can amplify what you've been told by using this form of study, as we're going to see, because that's what we're going to do now. Now you just take all that information I threw at you, and we'll be going over this paper. What you want to do is highlight or underline number 1301. We're going to begin right there.
Can I just interject something on that
yes.
note before we get beyond it?
Mm-hmm.
Just in this study on praise, in looking up the different words for praise, there's a very specific connotation that is attached to one that is all about thanksgiving and a dedicatory praise that's very much about a specific, like a priestly offering of praise in worship versus just laudation or acknowledgement or, you know, that type of thing. So just in that the brief study overview, there was a few different definitions that had been connected, same word praise in English, but there was definitely throughout there's some different numbers given and a little,
that's a good point.
A little different.
Let me explain something else before we move on. Okay, since this,
maybe write those just a little bigger, brother, for the people that are going to watch this video, because just on looking on our little screen,
okay,
kind of hard to see.
All right. The hay here, and then the lamed. Remember, this is only a two-letter root. This, as we're going to see, we would have got into this, but let's go ahead and point it out with these two. This is only the parent root. And until you start adding to the family, you're not going to see what the parent root is trying to expound. And the different other letters that you add to it will make the parent root mean something else. So, especially in the Greek and in the English, this root will have many cognate or phonetic family roots. You'll still see the hay, but there'll be another letter yet next to it. But I guarantee you, back in the ancient Paleo-Hebrew, it will always have something to do, if the hay is in front of it, with either there being praise or their praise was being directed in the wrong direction. You see what I'm saying? But there, it will always have something to do with beholding or receiving a vision or something like that in the context of our scriptures. So yes, it can have many different, there can be many, because there's different parent roots, there can be many different words that are used. And especially if it's talking about a group of people in the temple opposed to us sitting here today. The type of stuff that they were to praise him with is not the type of stuff that we're praising him with right now. Mm-hmm. So you'll see the hay in there, but you'll see other letters or other words in English and Greek added to it because it's a different form of the word.
Right.
Yes. Mm. And I just started studying this stuff 2 weeks ago. And it's already shown me, well, everything I'm trying to pour out within this short, you know, time to give you the information. He showed me that just in a short 2 weeks. I don't have the book yet. I've been looking at stuff on the internet. Okay? Amen. Hallelujah. So, on this paper where you see the noon, you go to 1301, and you're going to see the two-letter root of this word, prophet. Now, most of you that are watching over the internet and stuff, I'll draw these a little bit bigger, but you won't be able to see, but listen. And if you guys have your pages there, look at the noon, and it'll give you a picture and a definition. See that there's seed there. All right? And there's also other things that it can mean, which we'll go through. But you'll see that the two-letter root of the Paleo-Hebrew, the hieroglyphics for the word prophet in English, is the nun, which is a seed, and the bet. Okay. The nun is a seed. And if you look at this, who would have thunk? Yahweh was showing this is a male seed. This is a seed that was planted into the earth. Yahshua And he was a Yahshua was the dominant seed that was planted in the earth, and the earth was without form and void until the seed was placed on the earth to produce. The bet means
house.
If you just look at these two, and as a matter of fact, if we look at the first Hebrew word of the scriptures, it's bereshit. It begins with a bet and ends with the tav. The tav represents the stake or cross, and the bet represents the house. So in the first word of the Hebrew Bible, we see that Yahweh's house would be built on the stake. There's the good news in the first word of the Hebrew Bible. That's a lot easier for me to understand than studying under the feet of 60 different preachers, pastors, and everybody has their different opinion about it. This is what it means. This is the purest form of the good news given to his people. It is so simplistic. Now here we see that the nun and the bet make up the two-letter roots of the ancient Paleo-Hebrew word that makes up the English word prophet, which is number 5029 in your Strong's. Okay? There next to 1301, you'll see the nun and the bet, and then you see the two little letters that say AC. That means it's action root. The action root of the nun and the bet means to flourish. Now look back at what this means. The nun is a what? A picture of what?
Seed.
Okay. And the seed is supposed to what? The action root?
Flourish.
Be fruitful and multiply. In that verse, in your scriptures, in the original Paleo Hebrew, you're going to see that.
Of course.
That's why it takes so many less Hebrew letters to make up the scriptures. Then you'll see the C-O there, which means concrete. C-O means concrete, meaning of the root. And you'll see that it means what? Fruit. So this seed that was planted was supposed to build a house. And what would come forth from that house? Fruit. Wow. Okay. Then we see the letters A, B. And then it says that's abstract. And that's telling you that it has abstractly been translated as prophecy or prophet. You see that? It's been abstractly conveyed to us as prophet. Now, this is also going to show us something when we get down here to B about a prophet that was sent by Yahweh. Remember, in the two-letter root, it's the picture of a seed and a house. This is Yahweh's plan, that there would be a seed planted that would shepherd us into the house. I go to prepare a place for you. Good thinking, because that was one of the verses we would have went over. Yeah, see how it begins to make sense, and all of these verses begin to start coming to your mind. It's clarity. Mm-hmm. He is securing our destiny by showing us these things. If we can stick to these things in these forms of study, we can protect our family and our loved ones from deception of the enemy, false teachings. I don't care what pastor, what whoever they're, rabbi or anything, if they're not coming at you with the goods, there's a good chance that Satan is using that person to deceive you and your family and divert you from the inheritance and the promise of this seed that is building the house. Okay, let's go down here to where it says V, the letter V, and you'll see noon, bet, they doubled it there. Okay, you see when they added one more letter to this, What did it do? It changed the definition of it. See, here we see the parent roots adding family roots, and then the picture growing and starting to mean something else. When Bethany and Brother Art were married, they were parent roots. They were the root of the household. Then Telmer came along. A letter was added to the family. And the family was defined now as a family, not just a couple. That's what happens when we see this process being used in Yahweh's language. And now they and they didn't stop there, by the way. Hallelujah.
Still writing a story.
But their family is where they're supposed to be today. These children are being raised to learn this stuff. Hallelujah. Okay, so here we see that when you add another bet to it, that it becomes the word hollow. Now, what would the word hollow have to do with the seed in a house? Because without the seed, the house is
empty.
Empty. It's hollow. We could just use these. If we had a set of scriptures with written, we could just teach right straight through right now and go into the kingdom. And we would see it in its pure, unadulterated form. When we got done and we got down to the book of Revelation, we go, heck, I know what to do. Theologians, Bible colleges, seminary schools are not teaching this.
Teaching their own thing.
The traditional teachings. They're the wrong thing. Amen.
Professional ear scratchers.
You're right. Tingling. Scratch me. Okay, let's go down here. We won't get into the participles and all that because that's kind of deep. Let's go down here to the bottom of the page where you see the letter B. And then we see this word under the definition, prophet. And once again, that's number 5029 in the Strong's Hebrew section of your concordance. This So what we're going to see is the hay, the bet, the aleph. Now, knowing that the aleph, this means strength. What is the strength of Israel? Who is the strength of Israel? So this, in ancient Paleo Hebrew, would have represented the name of Yah. Whenever you've seen that, you know they were speaking, if it's not talking about a personal strength or a man's strength, whenever we're just talking about their strength, meaning as a group of people, then the aleph or the ox head would represent Yahweh's name. So whenever you would read this in the Paleo script, you would, if it wasn't talking about by his strength he pulled himself out of the mud, it's talking about Yahweh, the strength of Israel. All right? Then the rest of that word prophet is made up. Oops, I jumped the gun on that. But this is what leads to that strength. This is the yod in ancient Paleo Hebrew. And the yod means, it means hand, see the little hand at the end, or arm, outstretched arm. Many times it's been translated as a closed hand. Something very simple. Okay, where was the strength coming from? Because now the next letter is aleph. Now let's read this together, you guys. Let's read this. What is this a symbol of?
Us. Beholding.
Us beholding and looking up into the Shemayim. This would be the house. So who is supposed to be looking up into the Shemayim?
The house.
The house. Whose arm are they seeking to be fed by, nurtured by, protected by?
Yahweh.
Yahweh's.
Just when the Torah were opened, and they had a little thing that they held with a little hand at the end, it's called the Yud.
It is.
That's what they would read the.
Because they would not even touch the scrolls once they were completed. These things were never touched by the hand of man. That's why they're robed and put in the closet. Because if you ask a rabbi, well, don't use the name around him, he'll flip out. But if you were to say, Rabbi, is that word Yahweh? He would say, definitely. Most definitely. That's why he's not to be defiled. We're unclean. Because they have not received Mashiach. They are truly unclean. And they know until Mashiach comes and gives them the land that they will remain unclean.
Wow.
Now, what we've done over the years is translated this by other letters and into other languages, and it comes up with the abstract meaning or definition of prophet. Wow. Right. Okay, but let's take this and make sense out of it, because we can't have what was written and what we're reading now contradict. It can't be. Now remember, there's always a positive and a negative to the definitions we see in the abstract definitions of the letters. That's why they do that. Because there is a positive and a negative to it. One of them is abstract, and one of them is concrete. Hallelujah.
So you have the stickman.
Right.
From the from 1984, but you're missing the nun from prophet. Are those, is that what you meant?
Oh, I'm sorry. Why didn't you tell me that? Okay, look. I was stuck on the praise. Okay, so let's reread this. The noon, bet, yod, and aleph. Let's reread that. This is a picture of a what?
Seed.
This is a picture of what?
The house.
So what is the house supposed to receive?
The seed.
Right? By the arm of?
Yahweh.
Who put the word on the earth?
Yahweh.
Genesis chapter 1.
Yahweh.
Right. Now, I'm glad you pointed that, because the next step was to reverse it. Okay. Now, first let's look at the definition there. Of noon, bet, yod, and aleph. Now, here we see that in the picture that this paints, this is showing us a picture of something. Is that the seed would build the house, and the strength that it would be done by Yahweh. We see that throughout Scripture, everywhere. Amen?
Yes.
Okay. Now here we see the definition that is, the concrete definition of that is prophet. Okay, one who brings forth the inner fruit is the definition. One who brings forth inner fruit. And see, notice here it says F-R-E-Q. That means how many times it was used, how frequently it was used in the King James Version, okay, or in the Scriptures alone, 320 times. If you go back through all of this, you'll see that these other forms were only used maybe 10, 12, 15 times. Why do you think that is? Because Yahweh works through His prophets so that form of the Word shows up more times in your Scripture. Okay, so here we see the definition is one who brings forth the inner fruit. So, this tells us something about a prophet. Let's go to Genesis. Chapter 1. Now remember all of these pictures that we're learning. And as we read these things, watch how it amplifies your understanding about what's written here. chapter 1, 11 and 12. Now remember, in verses 1 through 3, Yahweh's Ruach, who, that is Ruach HaKodesh, by the way, this is the Holy Spirit, okay, was moving forth on the waters, and the earth was out form, was without form and void.
Empty.
Not until the seed was planted, not until the word came forth, was there life in the house. Now, there's a rule concerning this seed that was planted that brought forth life. There's a rule to it. And this rule, every one of these prophets that are sent by him will convey. His plan will never change. He put man on the earth to multiply and be fruitful. And that's what will happen at the end of the thousand-year millennial reign. Forever. This is the plan from the beginning, and the blueprints have never changed. If the prophet, what we're going to see, if a prophet or a man that says he is led by Yahweh or whatever title he's wanting to use comes to you and it's not, it doesn't have the original layout in it, the original seed and its purpose to be fruitful and multiply is not in this man's message. I don't want to talk bad about people, but you guys know. He's full of falsehood. That's it. If he's not coming at you with the original plan, because Yahweh, he's faithful and just. He will carry out. Yahweh is not a failure. And when he told us to be fruitful and multiply here on this earth, he meant that. And that plan will come to pass. The plan didn't change halfway through the game. Or when Messiah, the Word, was manifest in the flesh. He come to begin the end for Hasatan, the adversary, the evil seed that has entered mankind's heart. So, let's look at verses 11 and 12 here. So, there's a rule to this seed that he's planted in the house. Now, remember, when he said, I do, and Israel said, I do at Mount Sinai, and he went to carry them over the threshold, which was the river, what did they say? What did the bride say? Put me down, I'm not going in. I'm scared. He was trying to take the bride into the house. We married, and I'm taking you into the house. And they said, put me down. I'm full of fear. There's a lot of things in there I don't know about. But he said, I promised you this house. You're my bride. And she turned her back on him. And she left him. That plan, that covenant, he is faithful. He is not an adulterer. It will happen. And these things show us proof that it will. The plan can't change. That means that he would have to take another bride. And if the husband is alive, that bride will forever be bound to him in covenant. The only way that covenant could be broken is if the man died, and you can't kill him. He's an eternal being. So if he joined himself to a Gentile church instead of Israel, that would make him an adulterer. According to his own word. So it must be the original plan, and all of the prophets and all of the men of Yahweh and all of the men of God and Zeus and everybody else, whatever they're coming at you with, if they're not coming with this, they're not coming at you with his seed and his plan for his house by his strength in his name.
Hallelujah.
Now watch. Bereshit chapter 1 verses 11 and 12. So here's the rules to the seed that was planted. Notice once the word came from the Spirit, then there was life in the seed. First there was just water and there was ground and everything else, but there was no life on it yet. And I submit to you that unless this seed goes into your house, there's no life in it. It's the same concept from cover to cover.
And it's hollow.
Yes.
They're bright. People are walking around out there. Let's not go into preaching. Let's do let's teach us language. Hallelujah. Now look. Beginning of verse 11, it says, and Elohim said, let the earth bring forth grass, And many times, here's that agrobiological concept. See, we come forth from the earth. And many times, the grass of the earth represents a group of people in the Law and the Prophets. The plant that yields seed. Here it is. Here's the rule of the seed. This is what we're seeing. Now notice where this man that's called a prophet came from. He was called out of the house to bring this message to the people. Because why? They had went out of the house and set up camp over here somewhere. So he would raise up a man of Yahweh out of the house and send that man to this people that were living disobedient, and he would give them this message. The message of the seed. That's why Yahshua gave us the parable of
the seed.
The seed and the sower. This stuff is... Whew. Anyway... Now, watch this. So in case they can't see that, I'm going to try to... My pen's running out of ink.
The poor preacher.
Yeah. I need to draw more and tell more. Send me some pointers here. Okay, now, let's go ahead and finish reading the verse. The plant that yields seed and the fruit tree. Remember when Yahshua... Now, you're going to see these types of letters in a verse that has to do with when he walked by the what tree? Fig tree. And it produced no what?
Fruit.
Then you're going to see these letters in the Hebrew there. Okay, the letters, the original letters show you everything that what the verse is trying to convey to you in its original form. Okay? That yields fruit according to its kind. You see that? According to its kind. So if a man is coming to you and he's trying to plant a different seed, that prophet was not sent by Yahweh. Notice that the definition says one who brings forth inner fruit, and it has to do with the prophet. Mm-hmm. If the man who is teaching you, prophet, preacher, I don't care, whoever you are, if he is not trying to produce the fruit that bears fruit after its kind, then that means you're receiving another kind of fruit. Mm-hmm. That which was never been ordained by Yahweh to put in his house that came from his seed. One of the biggest forms of deception coming from not adhering to these basic principles that we see in his language. Furthermore, that yields fruit according to its kind. That means that these men who are planting fruit were never supposed to plant anything other than the word that was planted in the garden. Yahshua was a living word, the living Torah, whose seed is in itself. You see that? There's the law of the seed. So if the prophet says he has a word for us from Yahweh, and it contradicts the original plan, then it's not from the original fruit.
Amen.
It says, whose seed is in itself on the earth. Where did we come from?
The earth.
The earth. So that seed was supposed to be planted in each and every individual on the face of this planet. And it says, and it came to be so. Why? Because he said it to be. He said it to be that way. Why do I have to do it like that? Why can't I eat anything I want? Why can't? Because he said it to be so. And if you want to be part of his household, be protected by his strength, and worship him and love him and him alone, then you must cling to that, the original seed. Hallelujah. Nobody will ever be entering that house by way of a different seed. That's what this hieroglyphic shows us. Now, verse 12. And the earth brought forth what?
Grass.
Dry grass? Brown grass?
No.
This grass was green. The plant that yields seed according to its kind. And the what? Tree that yields fruit. Why did he protect or guard the tree of life in the garden? Because a seed had entered the heart of his creation. And if they would have partook of that tree in the nature that they were in, they would have been eternally condemned from going into the house. This is the doctrine that the hieroglyphics in their definition show.
Absolutely.
And the men of Yahweh that have been sent by him must possess that seed. Now, and the tree that yields fruit. Notice that that tree that was produced by his seed produces a particular kind of fruit. Why are we building a Sukkot in the 1,000-year millennial reign? Because there were broken branches with dead fruit on it that are being regathered now that Yahshua has begun to drag all of these things back together once again. By what? The word of the prophets. Hallelujah!
Yeah.
All right. Whose seed is in itself according to its kind. Only that kind of fruit can be taught from a prophet. And Elohim saw that it was good. You see that? Now that plan is the good news. It's right there in the first chapter. We see it by the word Bereshit. And we see it by the seed and the house. Now, let's go to Genesis chapter 3. Verses 21 through 24. This is what happens to man when they try to plant seed that Yahweh has not ordained into their hearts. And Yahweh Elohim made coats of skin for the man and his wife and dressed them. And Yahweh Elohim said, "See, the man has become like one of us to know good and evil. And now, lest he put out his hand and take also of the tree of life," there it is, "and eat and live forever." Live forever in what? A fallen state. That means that Satan's seed would have always ruled the earth because it was in the heart of man. It was in the heart of the creation. So Yahweh said, "I got a plan. I'm going to prophesy. And I'm going to bring something to pass. And this is going to be involved. And it will be this in the end." Verse 23, "So Yahweh Elohim sent him out of the garden of Eden to till the ground from which he was taken. And he drove the man out, and he placed cherubim at the east of the garden of Eden, and a flaming sword which turned every way to guard the way of the tree of life." Does not... Now, once again, you're going to see these letters again used in verses like in the New Testament where it says that are not Yahweh's ministers as of flames of fire? So the same letters that are used in the hieroglyphics in that verse, you will also see in the verses in the New Testament. When you start doing your word study of the fire there that he placed, inside his ministers... What is that fire doing? Purifying what? The seed. And that same Hebrew word for fire in the New Testament will be able to be studied back into the Hebrew from English to Greek and into Hebrew. Okay? And it will be the same word and same definition, which will link you back to the same hieroglyphic pictures. Okay. To see the seed in its full encompass. Because, ladies and gentlemen, this is not just an Old Testament teaching. Let's go to Luke chapter 8. Verses 10 and 11. And he said, to you it has been given to know the secrets of the reign of Elohim, but to the rest in parables, that seeing they do not see. Now remember, this has to do with, he's saying they don't see this. They're following me like that. They're not understanding. Seeing, feeling, touching, the senses. He says they don't sense who I am. They don't see. They don't hear. He's giving them the same types of teachings that came from this language. Because that's who he was. He is the language. He is the Torah. He is the words. He is the letters. He is everything. He is the Aleph and the Tall and everything in between. Seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not understand. Now verse 11. And this is the parable. The seed is what?
The word of Elohim.
The seed is the word. So, if we look at the word prophet, and the definition of the hieroglyphic definition is one who brings forth inner fruit, then that's saying that the word of Elohim that came forth from this seed that was planted was his very word. And if a prophet is not coming to you with the word that he spoke through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moshe, Jeremiah, Hezekiah, it's not his word. It's a false prophet. Or it's a prophet teaching falsehood, which is basically the same thing. Do you see how much more this amplifies everything? Now, one thing I want to share before we start reading Torah is, let's go back to these two letters. Let me show you something. Here we see the Nun and the Bet, meaning seed and house, right? The way this works is if the two-letter root structure is changed, and the Nun's on this side of the house. See, this had to do, the prophecy and prophet has to do with the Nun before the Bet. Right?
Yeah.
So that means that the seed and the house would produce something. It would produce men that prophesied. It would produce men who brought his word. Now, once the Nun is on the other side of the Bet, what does that indicate? That once that happened, the house produced something.
Seed.
After its own kind.
There you go.
Hello! You know what this makes up? The English word son. The house that was disobedient had to be saved. So he produced something. First it was hollow. But when you look at this in another form, there's many forms of these letters. It means something else. This is the Hebrew word
seed.
Then, son. The house produced a seed. Aaron and Moshe go in to the world, Mitzrayim or Egypt, and what did they say? Let my son go. Even though the people were in, even though we were still yet sinners, he sent forth his son to die for us that we could be forgiven. See what this produces? Even though the house was in bondage, he raised up prophets. And what they did was, they said, let my son go. Why? Because the seed was in the loins of the people. The seed was within all of these people that would produce. And so-and-so begot so-and-so. And so-and-so begot her. And she begot him. And then finally somebody begot Mary. Miriam. Who would give birth to what? The son. Let my son go. In order for the household to be out of bondage, the son must be planted. The seed, the word of Elohim must be set inside of our hearts, inside of our minds, inside of our thoughts, and inside of our actions. And that's how he receives praise.
Hallelujah.
So, having gone through all of that, I really, really suggest that you guys all get one of these dictionaries. Mm-hmm. Let's start there. And all you have to do is email me or whatever, and I'll send you the link to go to his website. You can download it and work out the bugs after that. But I would really suggest that everybody gets one of these biblical lexicons from Jeff Benner. Just a huge amount of clarifying information in it. And will help you to look at these pictures and see if you're being taught the same thing from behind the pulpit or from and me. If you see me doing something that doesn't seem to fit up to what is being pictured, please tell me. Because I don't want to be held accountable for falsehood. This is an important role that we play. Mm-hmm. We have been called to a higher calling. Mm-hmm. We're not playing church.
Yeah. No. Life or death.
This is real. And we need to understand these things. We need to take both forms of the teachings that we get from the abstract thoughts, and we need to add those things to this, the concrete thoughts, so that we can make a conclusion, finally, to what is supposed to be conveyed to us through this beautiful language. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Amen.
So we'll take a break and then start reading Torah.
Okay.
Amen.